Welcome back. I'm Connie Sokol, your host, back to talking with more wonderful guests. Today, I am so delighted to once again have Susan Madsen with us. Susan, thank you so much for taking time.
Great to be here today.
Love talking with this amazing woman. And why? Because she has stellar information and the magic of being able to grab that information and link it with life skills, life hacks, and life needs so that we can actually apply the information that she has so carefully garnered. Love this woman. If you don't know or remember, let me refresh your memory. She is considered one of the top scholars, global scholars and thought leaders on the topic of women's leadership. It is incredible that we get to have her. Can I just plug that in again? She's authored or edited 6 books and published hundreds of articles and chapters and reports in US News and World Report, the New York Times, and the Washington Post, and so many more. And she also, with her left toe, finds time to serve on many nonprofit and community boards. And recently, you just had a new appointment. You want to tell us for a second about that?
Yes, I've been at Utah Valley University in the Woodbury School of Business for many, many years, probably, I think it was about 18 years. And I started the Utah Women in Leadership Project at that time. And then July 1st, 2020, I transitioned and really brought all my work, including my Utah Women in Leadership Project, to the Huntsman School of Business at Utah State University. And in addition to the Huntsman School of Business, I'm partnering very strongly with USU Extension, which is USU is a land grant university. And so they go through all the states, all the counties, all the cities. And Connie, I'm just committed that this is not just for women who live in, you know, urban areas, but it really is for women no matter where they live, whether it's in a rural farming community or whether it's in downtown Salt Lake or other states around or other countries, I should say.
Absolutely, I just got chills. And I see this, I am talking to women and the thing I keep hearing from them is this collective rumble. They feel this groundswell of women rising, being able to reach that measure and fulfill the measure of their creation and be able to move forward in these leadership capacities and not in the way that we may have looked at them before. I don't know if this is something you're seeing in your research, but as I'm listening to women, if I may say, we've had a great deal of masculine energy, so to speak, over the many years, which is wonderful. There's many wonderful things about that. And yet a lower level of that feminine energy to balance and to be married to that. And I'm seeing this uprising of feminine energy of the way we do things as leaders. We don't feel like we need to be pinstripe suits. We can be nurturing. We can do relationships. We can fill needs. And I think women do that so beautifully. So have you noticed that as well? Is that just something I'm hearing?
No, I have been noticing. As you know, I've been doing research specifically in the state of Utah, but globally as well, for 2 decades now on women's leadership. And especially with the ground level work that I do in the state of Utah, we're just seeing some movement. I've seen some movement more in the last 5 years, but I would say in the last year or two, there's some energy coming forward, some more energy around women in politics, women in voting. We see that with all states, and we see that in the state of Utah, that more women we've seen in the past year some disengagement, but yes, now we're seeing some engagement, and especially for community things, when you see the percentage of women voting, sometimes people think, well, that's not the most important thing. Well, actually, it shows a lot. When you have more women voting, that means they're caring about some of the issues. Then they find their issues. Then they find their voice and want to speak out. Then they're willing to see themselves as leaders. And I think we still have a lot of work to do, Connie. We really do have a lot of work to do. But we see more, as we see more women stepping forward to lead in different ways, formal and informal ways, what we then have is more role models. And the research is absolutely clear that when girls and when teens, young women, see women using their voice and leading informal is really important, but also informal ways, you know, taking that yourself and moving it forward, saying, I'm going to take this. I'm not going to wait for someone to ask me. Then girls and women see that. And that is going to be a cycle on them then having that leadership identity of seeing, does that make sense? Seeing themselves as leaders and knowing that that's part of who they should be.
Absolutely. It creates that new norm. It's that, no, this is normal. This is what we do. And we see this in societies, regardless of what specific research, I don't want to say regardless, in addition to that specific research, who are the people in communities that usually are getting these causes off the ground? The food pantries, the fundraisers and the food drives and all of those things. You see a lot of women who, like we said in the last podcast that we had together, you talked about when a woman feels called to do something, that she will actually put more behind it and feel more credible and more validated in doing that. And I see this happening. This, like you said, these pockets, and when the women are voting, I think one of the reasons why is they feel they do have more of a voice. They are coming to sit at the table, as Sheryl Sandberg was talking about, inviting us to the table and sitting down and knowing we need to be there. I love it. What do you think are some of the reasons why that's happening now? What are some of the good things that are happening to make this shift, as slow as it may be, but it's moving, it's getting that flywheel going? What are some of those pieces?
Well, one of them is really what we've talked about, is that they are seeing other women stepping forward. So that's a piece as well. But I also believe that, and we're going to talk more in just a little bit about education, especially, you know, in the last decade or so, and we're really seeing that energy in the state of Utah with women getting their education. There's really a link between your advanced education specifically, well, even in other countries. The more, you know, if you're in Africa and some of these countries where you don't necessarily go to college, the more the better. So just making it to sixth grade, making it to ninth grade, making it through high school, the more education, the better. And it is very connected. And we'll talk about this in the morning in a little bit, but in a minute. But the more that you do have education, the more self-esteem that you do, and some other things that we'll talk about. So I see that as well. But as you know, there has been some disruption in and really some uncomfortable stuff taking place, and some things that women are just saying, okay, that's enough. That's enough. And maybe it's pushed us. We as women often like to stay in our comfort zones and until we get enough. And then you say, wait, this is disadvantaging my children, or this is halting this good work that needs to happen. And therefore it's no longer acceptable. This kind of incivility, this kind of unkind treatment of groups or individuals, these things just don't feel right to most women. And so it's like, how long do you sit back and wait for others to do it? And then when is it that you move, you know, that tipping point that you move and lean in, you know, or step forward and say, wait, this is not right. This is not Christ-like. This is not civil. And so you see many things that have upset that, you know, from really starting back in the Me Too movement, that's really, that launched some things forward. And then, of course, all of the other things, you know, and the pandemic, of course, is crazy, right?
I love what you're saying, though, and we're seeing that these cogs are turning. And like you said, when women, they're tolerant, and then they go, enough. And now it's time to create that change. And I love that. And it's not even just from a religious perspective or a woman's perspective. There's plenty of research that you have done and showed that when women get in and make changes in community, or the way that we treat women in a community is the way that community is going to go. Oh, and it's not good if it's not good treatment. So I love that you've got the data to back this up, to say, this isn't just a woman saying, hey, I want to be treated better, which should be enough. But it's saying, listen, this affects on so many levels what happens to the women, right?
Absolutely. And I don't know if you are familiar with Valerie Hudson's book.
Yes, beautiful.
Her latest book, I've got it on my desk here. Let me just look at the title. The First Political Order just came out I think it was in March. It was right at the beginning of the pandemic, March or April. And it is based, it's fabulous work, just fabulous work on women around the world. But she comes down to the finding and the fact, actually. There's enough research that I could say that it is a fact. And that is that society's views around gender, around women, are really based on the treatment of women in her home. So the way that a couple interacts, if there's two people in the home, the way the husband or the partner treats the spouse is a determinant of how the country treats and values women as well. And you really do see, she's talked about before and others have, that you know, there's, especially with the Taliban and some of those things, that a woman's voice, when the mother has more education, when she has her voice, that actually those, her kids do not go in that direction of joining the Taliban or, you know, the other groups related to that. So a woman's influence as a mother, as a society member, as an employee, as an employer, really makes a difference in how society thrives. Should I say that? How society actually thrives.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it makes complete sense because the women are such a hub, and it's not a diss or a denigration of men at all. It is, that is such a role of women. And we all know that they kind of the glue of society. And we all kind of talk about that. So let's go right into that segue into what education has to do with it, because if that's affecting those kind of situations of them not getting into the Taliban, how does that help us and affect us as women? In, you know, suburban, or, you know, if you're in the rural area of Idaho, like, how does this affect? And I think sometimes women don't understand the value of education. So talk to us about that. For the everyday woman, what is the value of education when they might be like, well, maybe later, you know, 20 years from now?
So we've been doing research. I've been doing research for a good 12 years in the state of Utah specifically, but also looked at research beyond that as well. And one of the things that I published early on that I didn't think a lot of people really understood, and that, and for women themselves, but also people that influence women, right? Because women may want to go to college, but people who influence, like mothers or mother-in-laws or spouses, may make it so difficult for her to go back to college. So it's not just a woman understanding these benefits, but it's people who influence. So one of the things I published early on was really, what is the value of education for women? Why should women actually complete as much education as possible? Particularly in the United States, we talk at least bachelor's degrees, right? Or associates and bachelor's degrees. And actually the research is very strong that people who are more educated actually whole set of research on health and well-being. So they actually live longer lives. So they have overall healthier lifestyles. Of course, not every person who is educated, but they tend to exercise more, have healthier diets, higher fiber, you know, which is related to diseases, smoke less, less overweight. Overall though, one of the coolest things in the research around health and well-being is that people who are more educated tend to have increased life satisfaction and overall happiness and resilience. Oh my, resilience right now is so important, especially in our teenagers and so forth, but with women as mothers and different things, and less depressed. More educated people tend to be less depressed. So that whole area, there's other things, there's plenty of research in that, but I just because of the more education, being aware, when you have more education, you tend to, not every time, but you tend to be more of a lifelong learner. So you're reading and studying things more after you've gone through, you know, at least a bachelor's degree. And then of course, Connie, you know this already, and most people know it, that when you have more education, you earn more money. You have better job opportunities. You have better benefits like healthcare, lower risk of unemployment. You're just better prepared to, even if you're not working full-time outside the home, you're better prepared to financially support yourself and your family, whatever your beliefs, you know, if you believe both men and women should work outside the home, or, you know, as you well know, that we can't depend on a spouse always earning, you know, being the breadwinner or whatever. So the third area of the five that I talk about really is, of course, the more education we have, the higher intelligence we have, better lifelong learning skills, more, you know, intellect and knowledge and things, of course, around English and science and math and those things. But cool benefits like stronger teamwork and interpersonal skills, and of course, writing and verbal skills. The coolest, one of the coolest, I think, in that section is really higher critical and creative thinking. And in today's, and even our ability to shop more wisely, you know, that critical thinking and being creative with all kinds of things. We have to do that as mothers, Connie, all the time, and grandmothers.
All the time. Doing the deals.
And, you know, enhanced, of course, analysis skills and those things. So sometimes I do, I have a couple other areas, but I need to stop and just say that sometimes I'll have people say, well, I don't need to finish. I've heard this so many times through the years because I'm just going to be a mom. And it's like, oh my, I mean, that's the best reason in the world to get a college education to graduate. So the parenting, especially, you know, especially the research around the time spent, typically more educated parents do spend more time reading to their kids, preparing them academically for school. There's been research through the years on more those kids with more educated parents do have more opportunities for extracurricular activities, which enhance their lives, healthier lifestyles. Of course, you know, generally speaking, if a mother and a father are more educated, their kids are going to be more educated. That makes sense. So which is important for the next generation, right? You want your kids to take care of themselves. You were just going to say that.
I was just going to say, and this dominoes, this is back to that new norm that we're talking about. If they see that the parents are educated, that's the way we should do this. Like, that's how this should go. And it's very doable. I know my kids, knowing that I have a bachelor's degree, they're like, oh, well, that's completely attainable. My mom has done that. So I could do that too. It doesn't seem so anxiety ridden, right?
And it's love expectation too.
Yes.
Parents have it. It's an expectation that they will too. And the last area that I really talk a lot about and have for over a decade is that there is an interesting link between people that are more educated, women and men, and their engagement in the community, their civic and community engagement. So we do know that more educated folks vote more. They actually donate more blood. They, you know, get involved more in leadership roles. They are just more conscientious at being involved in the community. And I just forgot, there is one more category, which is self-development. And that really, we've seen from the research on more educated folks that they really do have more higher levels of leadership skills, higher ethical and moral standards, better self-esteem and self-confidence, and just more open to tolerance, to diversity generally. Not every woman and man who is educated is going to be the same, but all of those things. So when you look at, Connie, when you look at, you know, just saying, well, women should be educated because that's the right thing to do, it's way beyond that. It's so beyond. It's the quality of life. It is really being able to reach your potential more, not just get by, but actually prepare yourself to lead, prepare yourself to influence, prepare yourself to really impact in greater ways. It's important to serve in all ways. But as you know, Connie, I have a very strong belief that we must have more women prepared to, with the confidence and with the education, to use their voices in ways that impact individuals, but also impact societies. And that happens through public policy, that happens through, you know, changing the laws and changing cultural norms and things that it really does take a lot of effort and a lot of work and a lot of head, heart, and hands, right? All those three together.
Absolutely. And you are so right. I'm thinking of a friend of mine. She's a mother of 12. Mm-hmm. And she is in Oregon, and she has been a spitfire flying to DC and working with the Oregon legislature and in all of these educational reform and things like that. And she has been pivotal because she's got boots on the ground with what she's doing with her kids and what's happening in their school districts and things like that. And she's got that lens. And then her education has lent her to that credibility, so to speak, of having a way of being able to deliver that in a very articulate way. And I see this as an important thing for women to be distinct and different and articulate, to be able to take up those causes and have the ability, the life skills to be able to make the difference. Because what you're saying is all of this comes down to creating a culture of education so that we can have better contribution. That's really what it sounds like.
Absolutely. I love how you just said that. It's just, it really raises that level of confidence, which and then is linked really to contribution. So it's just so important, I think, whether you work outside the home or work at home. Did you notice? We work hard when we work at home, that unpaid care work.
Raising 7 kids, I can tell you right now, that was absolute work. So yeah. So let me ask you this question, because I get this a lot from women as well. We have just established beyond measure the importance and the value of education for women, no matter whether they're raising children or they're working outside the home or whatever, working inside the home, as you just said. What happens when women want to do that and get pushback? What have you seen are some ways that women can find the workarounds to do what they know they feel need to do, but that people who maybe are not as a forward thinking and not as understanding of the need for this, not a fluffy want, a need for this. What are some things that you've seen that women can do to ameliorate that?
Well, first of all, I guess I will divide it into two, because I've seen so many women actually get pushback from themselves. So they're saying, well, I'm not important enough. Or I had a woman whose husband, very wealthy, very well known, who actually said to me after I did a Latter-day Saint fireside, this was years ago, I still remember that. She came up to me, she waited till everybody else was gone with all their questions after, and she just wept. And she said, I've always felt like this hole in my heart and my head because I didn't finish my education. But she said, I felt like it was selfish. I felt like that was saying that I'm more important than my kids, and I've been taught to be selfless. And so oftentimes, and I have had men come up and say, I've been trying to get my wife to go back. So it's not always external people. Sometimes it comes from those voices that we have heard in being socialized. So that is more important for women, men to go to college. Those, some of the voices say that, which is not the case in reality. So I think there's that set of voices. And when you look at the list, and I have so many resources, utwomen.org reports, if you need that good evidence to say, look, actually as a parent, I need to have a bachelor's degree to really benefit my own children, to serve in society. Like, especially if you're a Christian and you feel commanded to actually make a difference and contribute into society, there's such a connection to those. So we as women need to convince ourselves sometimes, especially if we come from an upbringing that doesn't value higher education like others. And we may be a first generation student, which is fabulous. I've seen so many women who are first generation students do exceptionally well. I love them in my class because they're typically like really valuing their education. I love it. So there's that side, I have to just say that we need to work with, because if we're committed, if we see it and we want to, we can make it happen. We can, even on our own. I've seen single mothers make it happen. However, it is much better if you have support, a support system. And I have seen single mothers go back, and one set that I'm thinking about, her in-laws, who her husband had left, but her in-laws were totally committed and helped with daycare once a week for her children so that she could go back. And even that was just gave her what she needed to get the energy to really go back and the financial, you know, and there's great finances for people, especially in need, to go back as well. Now, back to your real question, though, and that was what.
Oh, really quick there. I just want to second that. And the way that women can go about that, I want to pause for just a second on the other pushback, but that I want to add my witness to that, because when I got married, I was a year away from finishing. And I said, I am determined to finish and I feel strongly about it. And I got pregnant that first semester. And then after I had the baby, I deferred my teaching semester to the next fall. But even then I felt like he was too young for me to leave because he had some special things that he needed. And I just bumped it to the winter. But we made that, I made a lot of sacrifices for that to make that happen. And I am so grateful that I did. I have used that degree in raising my children all the time. And I see other women do this. A mother of nine, she went back, finished her degree after raising her children for 15, 18 years.
Wow.
Finished up. She is finishing now. And she actually is planning, it's in event planning. And she is now doing planning for events for me. And the reason why I wanted her is because she gets it from the mom perspective of what it takes for women to leave the home to go to a retreat, right? And then get the education side of, okay, how do I plan this? How do I do this effectively? And she's been using it for her life. She's planning weddings better. She's doing all of these big reunions and everything. She's using it in real life. So I just wanted to second that and put that nail in there a second way. So thank you for bringing it up. Now talk to us about the other kind of pushback.
Well, and that really is so important. So I loved what you just said. And even better, Connie, if we can get, I mean, it's great for women to come back of all ages, but even better on this new, this, you know, younger group coming up, let's get those young women into college to stay in college and get those degrees. So those benefits of those degrees can really have an impact from a younger age. We do see more women coming back in Utah and getting them later, which is great. I think we should do that. But again, you can really utilize that self-esteem and some of those other things if we can get young women to stay in school and do that. And if they take a break to do Latter-day Saint missions or whatever, the key, I've done so much research on this, is that oftentimes parents say, well, they should earn their own money. Parents need to help with some of the finances to get them there. And then if they take a little time off for a baby or a Latter-day Saint mission or the Peace Corps or whatever they're gonna do, don't come back and say, let's have them work a semester or two to earn money. Get them right back in college. They can get a part-time job, but help them with funding to get them right back. Because as we know, you know, once you marry or and have children, everything is more difficult. So I just wanted to.
I love the point you bring of that support system for this. So parents, that it's good to do that. You're not making it soft for them. You're actually helping them to achieve that. And I remember I was at a book signing at BYU. I met this gal and she came up and she just got her degree that day. 20 years it took her to do her degree. I was like, kudos to you, gave her a book. But I was like, kudos to you. So that she was talking about the support of her husband, that she had the support. And I think these young ones that you're talking about, I see more of a trend of, it used to be, at least in my day, if you were getting married, well, automatically you would put him through school and that's how it worked. Now I'm seeing more of a, let's help each other put each other through school for the first year or so. And let's get some of these things finished up together and value each other's education.
Yeah, I love it. And one interesting trend that we see, particularly in the state of Utah, but I've seen it other places, which is confusing to me, is actually, let's help, you know, pay our kid, you know, can work our child and do some, we'll add some money to help that child get through. But then when he or she gets married, then, oh, they're on their own. Actually, you need more help when they get married. So my pitch is keep helping financially, even if you're not paying the whole thing, you know, just even a certain amount can really keep that energy up, but don't stop once they get married. I was poor when I got married. I don't know.
Yeah. And you're thinking, can we afford, you know, the meal or do we afford utilities? Right. I mean, yeah, you make a great point. Cause I had not considered that once they get married, but that is that is an area of their lives that I could get behind and say, I'm going to keep helping you, because that's just that stair step that just turns all the dominoes for their opportunities. So that's beautiful. I love that.
And we've seen that pushback with parents. Well, they're on their own. They need to do it. Well, you know, there's a combination. And one thing that we don't want to do is have our kids in huge amounts of debt when they finish their degrees. So helping girls and boys start saving money for college when they're young. And Utah has, and they welcome people from other states, a great My529 plan that is as good as any place in the nation. And actually, I have two grandchildren, Connie, and both of them, when they were born, I set up a grandparent My529. And even though they get a small gift for Christmas and their birthdays, you know, I put $100, and it might not sound like a lot, but it is going to build up over time, and they'll have that as a piece of support from the grandparents to go to college. It's specifically to go to college.
That's so beautiful. And what a simple way to do that. And that's My529 plan. Is that the website we should go to?
My529.org, I believe, is the website. And that's for Utah, is specifically in Utah, but they welcome people from any state. And we have so many people. I've partnered with them in the past, so I know quite a bit about it. But it's a great plan. And it is good for parents to do, for grandparents, for uncles and aunts, whoever wants to help. So back to, we've kind of round.
Oh, I know. And I love this. I love talking to you because I feel like we're literally in pajamas and we could go all over the map. It's such good stuff. But yes, back to this original point that we're going to bookend now with everything. Yeah.
So the other thing is, how do you deal with other people maybe not being supportive? Well, the first thing I always talk about is awareness. So awareness and education, we need to do that for ourselves, right? But just that list of benefits from so many studies, oftentimes people that influence us, could be parents, could be grandparents, could be neighbor, you know, whatever it is, they really, you know, I've found through the years, a lot of them just don't realize how many benefits come from a college education. We did extensive research 11, 12 years ago in the state of Utah, shocking results on how few women even understood the benefits. They thought it was all about economic. And if they weren't going to work, you know, I'm not planning, then why get an education? So the broad value of education, I think, if you can get to those wonderful influencers to, if you need to, put the economic benefit in there, but also how it can help you be a better mother or a better community member or a better grandparent or whatever you are. I think that is the bottom foundational kind of basic level that we need to do. And to really rise to your potential, at least in my religion, which I'm from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, there's so many wonderful quotes from, I've got a whole collection from different prophets, from different leaders. And I found actually those in some of the other religions as well, on the importance of education and the importance of using that to contribute to society. And the more, of course, we know about motherhood and parenthood in general, the more education you have, the more you're going to be able to help your children. And they're going to, you know, use you as an example, and especially your daughters. If you're not educated, well, one of the things that we found specifically in one of our studies was that if the mom did not have an education, a college education, that two other things could kind of help make up for that. And one of them was if the daughters and sons, but I'll talk a bit more about the daughters, saw their mom going back and taking classes, that they're like, oh, okay, I need to go to college and graduate. And then another thing in addition to that is when their mothers talked about, I should have gone to college, this is why I should, you know, and then they get back into college and they see, even if it's just one class at a time. One of the things, I want to shift a little bit, because one of the things that just came to mind, one of the findings that was super profound in the research that we did about a decade ago was the very strong either or mentality instead of and. And we found this specifically in college decisions of young women, where they really believed from their socialization that they couldn't go to college and get married or have a child. It was mostly around having that first baby. In their mind, it was, okay, now I go to college and then I have this baby and then I'm not going to college anymore. It's all or nothing. I mean, and this mentality that you couldn't do them both together is very strong. Or maybe I'm a bad mom if I go back to school. But that's just not accurate. Actually, more women, the research has said, even if you go part-time, so that's another thing we picked up, is that their mentality was it's full-time or nothing. But there's all kinds of things in the middle. You can go online. You can go out once a week to college. You can do this or that. Of course, we're in the pandemic, so we don't have as many options. But one thing that we know is that actually people that, let's just say they have a baby, but one evening a week, they go out to class. It is so good for your mental health. It is so good for your mental health. It's good for your confidence. It's good to, I don't know, when I was mothering full time, just trying to get, I'm a list person and the list never got done. And it felt, you know, you do the dishes and then the dishes are there again and you just kept going and going. So being able to really keep your mind engaged and feel part of the conversations in the community, and not either or, and you mother and help in your church or do these for a combination, maybe not too much overwhelming, you know, depending on how you handle multitasking. But there's some real benefits to being able to do that. And you can just take one class at a time if that's what feels good to you, if that feels right to you.
Love everything you said. And that's what that one lady that was 20 years, she just took one class a semester. But think about the impact of her kids watching her study for her tests, hearing about how she did it. Did she do well? Did she not? What did she do for study habits? Understanding and relating to her own kids that way, seeing her achieve a goal step by step, drip by drip. This is just phenomenal. We are teaching them exactly what we want to teach as moms in the doing of it. And I love the point that you bring out, that this education, this idea, this mindset is what's so important. I know this getting out and being in a different environment. Darren Hardy talks about that, the research on environment and how much it influences and affects us. When my kids were young, I had 4 kids, 6 and under, and I would go out one night and I would go to Barnes and Noble for 2.5 hours because I wanted to read uninterrupted. And I get a slice of cheesecake and then I would come home and I literally lived on that all week. Just that, getting out and reading and feeding my mind and soul. So this for women, especially women of today, this is a huge piece, and I love that you brought that up. It's that feeding your mind and soul so that you have more that you can give and share. And so often the things that I was reading, I was putting right into my family and utilizing that as I was raising. It was helping me problem solve. It was helping me influence for good. All of those things mattered. In fact, as we wrap up here, I'm going to share one quote. I don't know if you probably have heard of Ava Weitzman's Women and Education, right? A Future Only God Could See. And you can find that at BYU Devotionals. It's Ava Weitzman, Women and Education. But this is one quote that I've loved from this, and I printed it off for myself and for other women. Sisters, never question the value of your education or wonder whether you will have an opportunity to learn and use the knowledge you have gained. God knows you. And even though you may not yet know his plans, he knows the end from the beginning. He is preparing and qualifying you for the work he wants you to do. He will continually guide you to ways in which your knowledge and skills can be of benefit to yourself, your family, your community, and his kingdom. I love what you have said, because that is just that beautiful wrap up of everything that you have just outlined of the why and the how of what she is saying in here. What beautiful, powerful, in the most feminine, beautiful way you women are of being that example for all of us and leading the way of how to lead, how to get your education, how to do that and do it in the mix of everyday life and not and keep it all part of a whole. I love it. Is there any last thing that you would love for the women to know about education that we may not have touched on?
I do think just one last thing, and I do think it goes back to kind of the either or and, because I've seen that so strong. Mm. But sometimes we see, especially in my religious context, we hear the words like, it's not my season, it's not my season to do this, or I'm going to wait, or people tell us, it's not your season to do this. And I will just say, Connie, every one of us is different. And I push back on that. That's what I'm saying. I push back on that, because what the research has found is really, we can raise our children and we can serve in the community, and we don't have to do everything full blast, but continuing to move our education along, including graduate degrees, associates and bachelors are important, but really getting up to those leadership roles, having a master's or even a doctorate is important too. But we don't have to do everything full blast. We fit it in. And just for me, I've had to listen to God throughout my life, because people will tell you different messages, your parents, your siblings, people in your church groups, people in the community. But what matters is what God tells you. That is what really matters. And what we know is, I shouldn't be judging you, Connie, because I don't know what God has told you. You know that. People shouldn't be judging me. They don't know what God has told me. And God tells me a lot of things, and I follow what inspiration I get. And so every woman out there needs to get her own personal revelation from God or from a higher power or from whatever she believes, to be able to do what she feels called to do and to prepare for what she could be called to do down, you know, in the future. So I love the quote, Henry Eyring once said that the real tragedy is, I don't have the quote memorized, is when we find ourselves not prepared to really step forward and take on the opportunities that only God could see for us.
Love that. Very Joseph of Egypt. All the way along, he didn't know, and then God was preparing every step. And we can have faith to know that if we feel the download, the divine download to do something, he is also prepared a way. So we will be able to partner with him to find the way to do it. Even if we're like, I'm too busy, I don't know where I'm going to get the money, I don't have the support, blah, blah, blah. Once we get the download, we can move on it. We can take a step, because he will help us with every step along the way. Love this. Susan, my soul has been filled. I know our listeners are going to feel the exact same way as they're listening. If they want more, they want to get that information, they want to get more from you, where is the best way to reach them?
So Utah, even if you're not in Utah, we have so much information. Utah Women in Leadership Project, utwomen.org, will get you to me. It'll get you to my email if you have questions, but also so many resources and research and resources for people in the state of Utah, but also beyond Utah as well. Lots of research, lots of resources, and we do lots of events. We have one event coming up soon on the imposter syndrome and perfectionism for women. So all kinds of topics, and we have a lot of videos for our past topics as well.
Fantastic. Again, utahwomen.org, and we've been talking with Susan R. Mattson. You are just incredible. Thank you so much, Dr. Mattson. We have just loved this and been filled. We would love your comments on this, and if you love it, rate, review, subscribe below to get more podcasts just like this. And as always, if you want fabulous freebies and mini courses and retreats and wonderful things to help you in your steps to move forward, check out ConnieSokol.com. Would love to connect with you and help you take that next step into living your purposeful, organized, and joyful life.